Today we have, I'm very happy to introduce Vipul. He's a professor here at CMU. And today he's going to talk to us about non-malleable circuit sharing. Vipul.
Okay, thank you. So I am Vipul, and I will talk to you about this new notion called non-malleable circuit sharing. So this will mostly be a high-level talk, not very long. Maybe I'll take 40 minutes or so. I will focus mostly on the new notion and why is it interesting, and some of the high-level ideas that we need to make this notion work. And please feel free to stop me at any time to ask any questions. Okay, so let's start with secret sharing. So secret sharing, it's a very fundamental primitive in cryptography. It was introduced in 1979 by Shamir and also independently by Bleakley. And if you work in cryptography, then secret sharing is kind of everywhere. So there are various areas in cryptography: secure multi-party computation, designing encryption schemes, threshold cryptography, and so on, where we use secret sharing in a very fundamental way. And even if you are not a cryptographer, even if you work in theory, the chances are that you have seen secret sharing somewhere or the other. So the basic setting is as follows. So we have here two algorithms, share and reconstruct. And we have a message, M, which we want to share. So let's call this our secret, okay? Now, share algorithm takes this message, and the message is broken into several parts or several shares. So let's denote these shares by SH1 to SHN. And then a subset of these shares are given as input to the reconstruction algorithm. And if this subset is large enough, then you can get the message back, the original message M, right? So what does the subset being large enough mean? We have several kind of possibilities in secret sharing. So the simplest is you need all the N shares to reconstruct the secret. So that is known as N out of N secret sharing. Another possibility is that maybe you're allowed to reconstruct the secret assuming that we have a threshold number of messages available. Let's denote this threshold by T. And then what we have is T out of N secret sharing, which is actually what was proposed by Shamir, right? So just as a crude example of where we might use secret sharing, so let's say, you know, I have some secret file, right? And I want to distribute the shares of this file to some members of the committee. And assuming that, let's say, half or more committee members are present, then they should be able to recover my document and discuss it. Otherwise, if we don't have a quorum, then my document cannot be recovered by a small number of the committee. So we need two basic properties from any secret sharing scheme. One is correctness, which says that any authorized set of shares can be used to reconstruct the correct secret. And then we have secrecy. Any unauthorized subset of shares has no information about the underlying secret. So the underlying secret is information theoretically hidden entirely, right? And this, what's the authorized set and what is not the authorized set, it's kind of a parameter in the secret sharing scheme. For rest of this talk, think of our access structure or the authorized set as just T out of N. If you have a threshold number of shares, you should be able to recover, and otherwise not. Okay, so typically the goal that we have in mind when we are discussing secret sharing is that there's an adversary and the adversary is trying to learn your secret, right? But what if the goal of the adversary is not to learn your secret, but rather to tamper with your secret instead? So in other words, you know, we have all these shares, right? And then an adversary comes along, and in some way, the adversary is able to tamper with all these shares. So let's call the resulting shares to be SH1 tilde to SHN tilde. And then you apply the normal reconstruction function. And then you get the message M tilde, which is the tampered secret. So in this setting, again, people have studied various notions. Some of these notions are verifiable secret sharing, error detecting codes, and AMD codes are algebraic manipulation detection codes. So don't worry about them if you don't know what they are. So there are various notions which are designed for this setting, and they all are concerned with like different type of attacks, and they all have different type of guarantees, again used for different applications and so on. So this notion of non-malleable secret sharing is also one such notion, so continuing the same line of work. And what do we want in non-malleable secret sharing? We want the following: that if an adversary tampers with all these shares using some tampering function f, which comes from some class of tampering functions, we will talk more about this, then we want to guarantee that any tampering entirely destroys the secret, or you don't tamper with the secret at all. So in other words, if the adversary tampers, then either the distribution of the tampered secret is independent of the original secret, so the distribution of M tilde should be independent of M, or the original secret remains intact, which refers to the case when the adversary decided not to tamper with anything at all. Okay, and yeah.
So the access structure is still the same, right? So if only the authorized subsets can recover the secret.
Yeah, the access structure is still the same. So just think of T out of N secret sharing. The reconstruction function takes any T of these tampered shares, and that's how we get this message M tilde.
So just was wondering then, what's the motivation of having the secret destroyed if it is tampered? Is that the adversary is thought of as, you know, can also get authorized access?
Okay, so think about something like the following. So let's say you have a smart card, and the smart card is signing your message or something like that, right? So it's not entirely related to non-malleable secret sharing, but this is like a tampering attack in cryptography. So now by, you know, applying some attack on the smart card, let's say the adversary is able to tamper with the secret key a little bit, and then the adversary is able to again like run the smart card and get the signature out. So in such a setting, when the secret key has been tampered with, you can imagine that now this new signature might leak something about the original secret key, and then if you run this attack, then potentially you might learn the entire secret key. So sometimes, you know, tampering can help you learn some additional information. You know, sometimes the purpose of tampering could just be to tamper. For example, you know, there is like a big file, and let's say the big file is a contract, and you secret share the file and store it across different servers. Now an adversary comes along, and adversary just wants to change something very specific in the contract, like name of some person, or maybe the adversary wants to delete one of the clauses in the contract. So in that case, the purpose of the adversary is not to learn the contract itself. Maybe it already knows, maybe it doesn't know, right? But if we are able to have such a guarantee, right, that any tampering entirely destroys the contract, then you have detected that, yeah, some tampering has occurred. And whereas if the adversary is able to like change the contract in any intelligible way, then that can be bad.
Why can this problem be solved as the signature? So maybe I misunderstand the problem.
So there's no key here, no secret key. So they, essentially, like, there's no cryptography throughout the talk. so the problem is, where would you store the secret key, right? If you assume that the share algorithm and the reconstruction algorithm, they share a secret key, then yeah, I agree with you, right? But here, you know, we are not assuming anything like that.
The problem is the verification key, wherever it is stored, the adversary could tamper with that as well. So then the checking procedure wouldn't give you the guarantee you want.
So if you use like an error correcting code rather than just detecting, then this could be circumvented, right? So even if it is tampered with, you can get back the correct message.
Yes. Yeah. So if you are using an error correcting code, then this notion is already automatically implied.
Secret sharing plus error correcting code, like read solvent, let's say, with random
coefficients. Yes. Yes. But note that it all depends on what this tampering function is, right? In its full generality, the tampering function can just like reconstruct the original secret, right? Then add one to the original secret, then share it back, and then you get M tilde. So you cannot handle all classes of functions F.
Right.
Yeah.
So just a clarification question regarding the second bullet. The classical secret sharing had M as arbitrary. Now here are going to assume M is stochastic?
No.
So what does it mean that the distribution is independent?
Yeah, so I will define it more formally in the next slide. Okay, any other questions? Okay, so here's a more formal definition of what we want. So let's say you start with the secret M1, and then you share it into various chairs, and then somehow the adversary is able to tamper and produce these tampered chairs, and then eventually you recover M tilde, which is the tampered secret. Now this is experiment one, and let's compare it to another experiment where instead of starting with M1, you start with a different message M2. Okay, and then again you run the same thing, and adversary tampers, you reconstruct, and then you get M prime tilde. Okay. Now what we want is that the distribution of M tilde and M prime tilde should be either the same or pretty close. And you can talk about these two secrets could have the same distribution, or they could have a distribution which is statistically close or computationally close. There are various variants which are possible here. Okay, so to answer your question, you just have to consider a distribution where there are two possibilities for the message. And regardless of which message you started with, you should end up with the same thing. Yeah.
And to clarify, in the two experiments, the tampering function of the adversary tricks can be different?
No, it's the same.
Oh, it's the same tampering
function. Yeah.
Oh, okay.
Same tampering function is applied.
I see.
So everything in these two experiments is the same, except for the message that you started with. And what we want is that the message that you end up with should be the same, should have the same distribution, essentially. And so there are no parties except for the adversary. We just have a share algorithm. We have a reconstruction algorithm. So there's like no place to store secret keys and so on, right? All that, you can extend the model to incorporate that. But I just want to keep the problem as simple as possible here. Okay. So now let's come to this red box a little bit, and let's see what's happening.
I'm a little lost.
Mm-hmm.
So if M1 is not the same as M2,
mm-hmm.
then don't we want, M tilde, in an ideal world, isn't M tilde supposed to be the same as M1?
So that's a much stronger guarantee, right? And that's just error correcting codes. So here we are looking for a weaker guarantee. We are just saying that either M tilde is the same as M1, or the distribution of M tilde is entirely independent of M1.
So my sharing algorithm, I'm missing something silly, so
yeah.
Correct me. I have a great sharing algorithm. I just throw away M1. I just store random elements into all these guys.
These tampered shares.
Right.
Right, yeah.
So is that good?
Yeah, we allow for that. I would call that a good non-malleable secret sharing. And we will see some applications of this.
So there is no requirement on when there is no tampering, you should be able to recover correctly?
No, then it follows from the correctness, right? Because secret sharing itself requires that if you have these shares.
So then that scheme won't work.
No.
It does not.
No, I think what he's saying is that the adversary just ignores these shares entirely and puts something completely different here, right? Okay, is that
so,
what you're saying?
So that was one possibility. The second one was the adversary does, suppose the adversary does nothing, and M1 is different from M2.
Okay.
Then M tilde 1 should be the same as M1.
Yeah, that follows because just from the fact that it's a secret sharing scheme.
Exactly. And M tilde 2, M tilde prime is the same as M2.
M tilde prime is the same as, yes, that's
so,
true.
But then how do they have the same distribution?
I think you replace it with a different symbol, same symbol, right? That's what I
mean. No, so yeah, that's a very good point. I should mention that this definition, when I'm talking about these distributions being the same, I am essentially conditioning on the fact that adversary did some tampering. Yeah, I should probably have mentioned here. Similar distribution, assuming that adversary tampered both. Sorry?
For every now and then, it's tampering function.
For...
That's what your condition is. So every tampering function is not the identity function.
Yeah, yeah. It should not have any fixed points, essentially. So fixed point means that every time the output is different from the input. Because the identity function is bad, but there might be functions which are not identity functions, but on most of the inputs give you the same output. Maybe only on one input the output is different, right? So what we need is it should be like an identity function might be just from the fact that it's not an identity function, that it does not follow that it's necessarily changing every time, right? So let's just assume that adversary is necessarily tampering every input. If it's not tampering, then we just of course require that M tilde is the same as M1. Okay, so now let's look at what exactly the adversary is doing. What kind of tampering do we allow? So the first observation is, let's make the adversary arbitrarily powerful. Adversary can take all of these shares and can tamper in any arbitrary way. So in this setting, I am claiming that in fact there is no non-malleable secret sharing which is possible. And why is that? The adversary can just take all these shares, run the reconstruction function to recover the original message, then just change that message to, let's say, M plus 1. Okay, then secret share M plus 1 to get SH 1 tilde to SH N tilde, and that's it. So that's a valid attack, and in that case your M tilde is M 1 plus 1. So the only possibility of having a non-malleable secret sharing would be if we somehow constrain the class of tampering functions that we are looking at. So in the next three slides, I will talk about various classes of tampering functions, and all of these have already found applications in cryptography which have nothing to do with secret sharing and so on. So it's a very simple notion. So the first possibility is individual tampering. The adversary is computationally unbounded. The tampering function which the adversary has is actually represented by these n tampering functions f1 up to f2 to fn, and all these act individually on the shares. So the function fi is acting on the share shi, and then fi of shi gives me sh tilde I. So now you compute all these tampered shares. So all of the shares are being tampered, but individually and independent of each other. And then you try to reconstruct, and then you get the message M tilde. And we require M tilde to be either the same as M, or its distribution should be independent of M. Okay? So any questions?
The more natural version would be the functions could depend on any unauthorized subset.
Great, so that's the next notion. let's make the adversary somewhat stronger. The adversary partitions the n shares into, let's say, two disjoint sets, could be more than two. And the first subset is this subset A, which has SH1 to SHI. And there's this function capital F, which takes all of these I shares as input and produces I tempered shares here. And then we have a function G, which does the same thing. And then you reconstruct and recover M tilde, and again you need the same guarantee. Okay? So this is called the joint tampering model, and one immediate restriction we must place in this model is, assume that you are looking at T out of N secret sharing, then this I must be smaller than T, right? Because if F can just get T shares, it can just reconstruct, and then this guarantee essentially is impossible to achieve. Okay?
But wouldn't a subset always have more than T shares if you are partitioning it into two different subsets?
That depends on what the value of T is. Right, if the value of T is much smaller compared to N, then you need to partition into much more than two. Okay, but now another natural question is, why do we need these subsets to be disjoint, right? What about what is called as the so-called as the overlapping joint tampering model? Okay. Now here we might have two functions. So think about N out of N secret sharing. For this picture, T is equal to N. So now the first tampering function might get SH1 to SHN minus 1 as input, and then maybe produces the first half of the tampered shares. And then we might have another tampering function which takes share 2 to N and then produces the second half.
Does it matter if you choose, let's say, different T size subset of the tampered secrets, tampered shares, and you get different outputs like M tilde 1, M tilde 2, and so on?
Mm-hmm.
Does it matter? Does it affect the security? Is this taken account of in the security definition, or it's irrelevant?
Yeah, so again, by varying what you're saying, it's possible to obtain several security definitions. For this talk, let's just assume that we are taking the first T and we are reconstructing the secret M tilde. Okay, so this line of works on non-malleable secret sharing is actually inspired by this very interesting line of work on non-malleable codes. So let's go back to coding theory. It was introduced by Dzomwoski et al. In 2010. So non-malleable codes, it's a relaxation. It's weaker than error correcting codes. So what we need here is that you encode your message into a code word C, and then there's a tampering function F which is applied to the code word C. So now you, let's say you get C prime, and then you decode C prime to get M prime or M tilde. Non-malleable codes guarantee the following, that either the tempered message is the same as the message that you started with, so M tilde is the same as M, or the distribution of M prime is independent of M. Okay? So this is a very similar guarantee if you look at what we want in non-malleable secret sharing. Now, this guarantee is clearly weaker than error correcting codes. Error correcting codes just require the first guarantee. And then why do we want non-malleable codes? You know, error correcting codes are possible only for a very restricted class of tampering functions. And we want to see what we can do if we go beyond this restricted class. Okay? Now, it might seem like non-malleable codes are actually weaker than error detecting codes as well. But for a technical reason, this turns out to be not true. So in error detecting codes, the following type of attack is possible. if, for example, your message is zero, then you get bought. So the like adversary causes an error, and the error is detected, and then the reconstruction algorithm will output bot. But if you started with a message one, then you end up with one, right? So now your distribution of the resulting message is bot or one, and the distribution actually depends on the message that you started with. So this is kind of called a selective bot attack, and in non-malleable codes, we don't want that. So again, clearly, non-malleable codes cannot be constructed for any arbitrary tampering function f. And the reason is, your function f can just decode the message, recover m, and then just encode m plus 1, which will be your c prime. And the active direction in this line of research is to expand the classes of tampering functions which we can handle. And the motivation for non-malleable codes actually comes from cryptographic applications. So again, you want to design, let's say you want to design encryption scheme where you cannot change the message m. Okay? Yeah.
I have a question. What if your decoder is simply random?
Sorry, what if your decoder?
Simply random. So it returns some number at random. Then doesn't it satisfy the requirement?
No, but in error correcting codes, we want to decode and recover the original message, right? If there was no tampering.
In non-malleable codes, your key is recovery being independent of input.
Conditions, if a tampering function is not evident, then you get back.
So you are saying that what if the tampering function just outputs a random? Okay. Okay, so let me try to give you some idea of why non-malleable codes or non-malleable secret sharing might be useful. So suppose you want to design an encryption scheme where an adversary gets the encrypted message, and the adversary should not be able to change the encrypted message. Okay, and should not be able to change, the message m to m plus 1. Of course, if you have had the decryption key, you can do that, but let's say the adversary does not, right? So this is called non-malleable encryption. And if you look at the typical ways of how we design encryption schemes, let's say RSA or El-Gamal, then the ciphertext has a very specific algebraic structure. For example, in RSA, it's easy to take the encryption of a message M, and it's easy to convert it into an encryption of a message 2M just by doing some algebraic operations. Now you can imagine that, let's say you had non-malleable codes which actually resist change of M to 2M. So this is a very specific class, affine functions, right? If we had non-malleable codes which are secure against affine functions, then you can actually design non-malleable encryption, assuming that in RSA, this is the only kind of attack which you can do. Then actually you can get non-malleable encryption against any class of adversaries, in nothing to do with affine functions. Right, so the basic punchline is that when you go to the world of number theory, it allows you to do some certain operations. And if you can disallow those operations by an appropriate code, an appropriate non-malleable code, then you are in good shape. Okay, so the most well-known model in which non-malleable codes have been studied is the so-called split state model, where the code has two parts, L and R, let's call it the left part and the right part, and the adversary tampers with each of these parts independently. So we are coming very close to our definition of secret sharing. So even though, secrecy is not one of the requirements in non-malleable codes, we don't need that using L you cannot recover the message, or using R you cannot recover the message. It turns out that actually non-malleable codes in this two split state model is also some kind of non-malleable secret sharing. It's a 2 out of 2 non-malleable secret sharing. However, if you go beyond 2, then such an implication stops holding. So in particular, a 3 split state non-malleable code need not be a 3 out of 3 non-malleable secret sharing. Okay. So, you know, there have been a number of works which have studied split state non-malleable codes. There are various constructions which have been proposed, and various connections to other primitives in cryptography have been proposed to non-malleable encryption, non-malleable commitments, tamper resilient cryptography, and so on. Okay, so now let's go back to the definition of non-malleable codes. So, you know, the code has 2 parts, and the adversary is tampering each of these individually. And we want M tilde to be independent of M. So how might one design something like that? Okay. So it turns out that if you look at all existing secret sharing schemes, it's somewhat unclear how you can obtain such a guarantee. So let's look at Shamir's secret sharing scheme. Let's say our T is 2. So we are looking at Shamir 2 out of N secret sharing scheme. The way it works is that you have the starting message M, and then you actually construct a polynomial whose zeroth point is N in Shamir secret sharing scheme. Since here, you know, our T is 2, it will actually be a line. The degree of the polynomial will be t minus 1, and in this case the degree is just t. It's very similar to read solve encodes. And now your shares will be just points on this polynomial. And if you have any 2 points, you can recover the line and you can recover the secret. Otherwise, the secret is entirely hidden from you if you only have 1 point on this line. Okay, and then you can generalize the secret sharing scheme even to higher values of t. Instead of this line, you would have polynomials, but again, if you have sufficient number of points, then you can just use interpolation and you can recover your secret. But if the number of points that you have on the polynomial is less than what the degree dictates, then the share is entirely hidden from you. Now, if the adversary actually individually tampers with all of these shares, then let's see what happens. What happens if you just add 1 to each of these shares? You would actually get points on another line, such that the zeroth point of this line now will be M plus 1. So even by tampering each of these shares individually, you know, you have been able to tamper with the secret in a very meaningful way. So, of course, this is different but related to M. And again, you know, this addition attack is not the only possible attack. If you just double each of these shares, then there are points on a new polynomial where the encoded secret is 2M instead of M. And this is possible because Shamir secret sharing is a linear secret sharing scheme. In fact, most of the secret sharing schemes in the literature, they are linear. And you know, linear secret sharing schemes, they follow these nice algebraic properties, which have been actually extremely useful in cryptography, for example, in secure multi-party computation and so on. We exploit all these properties all the time. But here for us, it's all bad news. We want to destroy any algebraic property which the scheme has, so that any kind of these intelligent tampering attacks are not feasible any longer. So how could one build a 2 out of 2 non-malleable secret sharing? Okay, so this turned out to be actually much harder than you can imagine. So the starting idea is actually very simple. So, oops. So you have two shares, L and R, and you want to see what they should be, right? Now let's try to just encode a single bit message. If you want to produce an encoding of 1, then you just choose L and R such that they are orthogonal vectors in this vector space. So you have a large field, and L is just n elements from this field, and so is R. And if you want to encode 1, then the inner product of L, R should be 0. So you are essentially picking like 2 random orthogonal vectors. If you wanted to encode 0, you can pick 2 vectors such that the inner product is non-zero. Okay? Now, if you actually picked 2 random vectors from a large field, right, the inner product is highly unlikely to be 0. Yeah. So now let's say you encoded 1. Okay. Now adversary comes to L and R and tampers with L and R individually. Now with very high probability, regardless of what the adversary does, the encoding always just becomes an encoding of 0. If you tamper with L without knowing R, or if you tamper with R without knowing L, then if the two vectors were orthogonal, now with high probability they are no longer orthogonal. Okay? So regardless of you started with 0 or 1, you always just end up with 0. So essentially your original bit is destroyed. Okay? Now going...
Maybe I just misunderstood the encryption scheme. Sorry, the coding scheme. Why 2 random vectors encode 0 with high probability?
Because they are, if you look at the inner products, right, the different terms, they are not going to cancel out.
Probably 0 is 1 over Q.
So this field is large. It's not a binary field.
Oh, okay.
Yeah.
Okay, so field is huge and n is small.
Yeah, it's important.
Okay, so
field has exponential number of elements.
Okay.
Otherwise, this doesn't work.
Okay, so
okay.
N might not even.
Why couldn't you do the other way around? So like small field and big n. It would work too, no? Or I'm misunderstanding.
If you take a binary field, then
yes.
Regardless of how big n is, right? The inner product will either be 0 or 1. And with probability half, this property no longer holds, right?
But I'm saying that it will still be non-malleable secret sharing.
That is not clear.
Why not?
For example, if I flip, then I can flip the inner product, right? If I flip a single bit, right? Assuming that the other bit is actually 1. So, okay. So, with probability half, the other bit is 1. Right? So, I just take this guess. And then if I flip the bit, then...
if you write, make guess right, you flip it. If not, you don't flip it. So, you get
no, I think
a uniform distribution on the decoder side.
I think you will get something where you can launch an attack with probability 3/4. Rather than half. This is because if my guess about the other bit was correct, right, then I am able to flip the bit from let's say 0 to 1. Otherwise my attack does not change the message at all. So this is still a valid intelligent attack. Right, if I take the encoded message with probability half, it's the same. With probability half I flip it. The resulting message still does not have an independent distribution.
Another quick question.
Yeah.
So one way of looking at...
And by the way, this is not a proof at all. The proof, this was a paper and the proof is several pages long if you want to prove it formally. Yeah.
Yeah. So my question is not related to this. So one way of looking at the traditional secret sharing is to consider it as a Ritz-Solomon code and have only one of the message symbols as the actual secret and the rest of it as...
Yeah, instead of zero, you can choose any point, yeah.
Right. So, if we go towards this using, let's say, non-malleable codes, so such a thing does not work. So, picking one of the messages as the secret and rest as rest uniformly at random, then I won't get a non-malleable secret sharing.
No, because if you for example, multiply rest of the messages by 2, then essentially now you have points on a polynomial. If the original polynomial was P, now your points are on polynomial which is 2P.
No, non-malleable secretion, so non-malleable codes. So they won't allow such tampering, right?
Oh, you are thinking about how to go from non-malleable codes to non-malleable.
Yeah.
Yeah, great. So I'll take this approach in building non-malleable secret sharing.
Okay.
Okay, and going from single bit to multi bit, again it requires a lot of work. I just wanted to give you a basic idea. And for now, I just want you to assume that 2 out of 2 non-malleable secret sharing exists. Now the question is, how can we build T out of N, non-malleable secret sharing? Okay? Any questions? Okay. Okay, so the question is about handling more advanced access structures. T out of N non-malleable secret sharing is, of course, the obvious next target. But what about non-malleable secret sharing for any access structure A in the class P? So in general, you can imagine that your access structure is represented by an arbitrary monotone circuit. And the number of wires in this, the number of input wires, will be the same as the number of shares. And you can set the value 0, 1 on these input wires. So the first input wire will be 0 if you don't have that secret. If you have that secret, then you set it to 1. Now the circuit will tell you 0/1. 0 means that this subset is actually authorized. Sorry, this subset is not authorized. 1 will tell you this subset is authorized to reconstruct the secret. And then, of course, your goal is to build such a secret sharing scheme. So, so secret sharing schemes have been constructed for P. So we don't know of any unconditional constructions, but if you assume one-way functions, then Yao had such a construction in the early 80s. And what about secret sharing schemes even in NP? You can again define it in a natural way. and we do have secret sharing schemes for NP. Can we build non-malleable secret sharing schemes for NP? Right? And again, by looking at different tampering models, individual, joint, overlapping, I'm sure that you can come up with your own tampering model here. We get a variety of different questions. Okay? So here are some of the new results which we obtained. So we have a construction of T out of N non-malleable secret sharing scheme. And so it works in the individual tampering model if you tamper with each of the shares individually. But the construction, in fact, also works in the joint tampering model, assuming that we have like 2 disjoint sets and their sizes are not equal. Why sizes are not equal, it's kind of a technical condition which comes from the proof. In fact, we also have a general compiler which can take any statistical or computational secret sharing scheme, realizing some access structure A, and using that we are able to convert it to a similar non-malleable secret sharing scheme for the same access structure. And this is in the individual tampering model. So as corollaries, secret sharing schemes are known for Boolean formulas or for monotone span programs. So we get non-malleable secret sharing schemes for similar classes. And using this result of Yao for monotone P, we get computational non-malleable secret sharing for P as well. Going further, secret sharing for NP, it has been constructed, but based on like very weird non-standard lattice-based assumptions related to program obfuscation and witness encryption. Now, if you are willing to make the same funky assumption, then you can get non-malleable secret sharing even for NP. So the first results were in the joint tampering model, and these results are in the individual tampering model, and we have at least like one very weak result in the overlapping joint tampering model, just a construction of n out of n secret sharing. Right, so as we are becoming more and more ambitious in what classes of adversaries we want to handle, our results are getting kind of progressively weaker. Okay. So as Rashmi was suggesting, let's try to use maybe 2 out of 2 non-malleable secret sharing in a black box way, and let's try to combine it with the T out of N secret sharing to get a T out of N non-malleable secret sharing. Okay. So here we start with the message, and first you apply 2 out of 2 non-malleable secret sharing in a black box way to get L and R. Now you break L and R again into N shares each using a T out of N non-malleable secret sharing. Sorry, using a T out of N regular secret sharing. Okay. So this A share, just A here represents the access structure, and for now let's just think of T out of N secret sharing as the access structure that we want. So using a regular T out of N secret sharing, you have obtained these L1s to LN and R1 to RN. And now your share I, let's put LI and RI in share I. Okay, so this is what your secret sharing scheme would look like. The first share will be L1 R1, second will be L2 R2, and so on. And now let's say the adversary is trying to jointly tamper with adversary is trying to tamper with all of these individually. That's the simplest setting. So adversary applies F1 on this share. So you get L1 tilde, R1 tilde, F2 on the second one, and so on. Now you try to reconstruct. So you reconstruct from the tampered L's, you will get L tilde. You reconstruct from the tampered R's, R tilde. Now you can recover the tampered message using this, which will be M tilde, right? Now what's the guarantee which this 2 out of 2 non-malleable secret sharing gives you? It tells you that if L and R were tampered independently, then your resulting message is independent of the message that you started with, right? But here it's not clear at all why this amounts to tampering L and R independently, right? You are storing shares of L and R together, and every time the adversary is modifying shares of L and R together, different shares. So now it's not clear how to rely on the security of the underlying non-malleable secret sharing scheme. You need to guarantee that R tilde is independent of L, and L tilde is independent of R. And if you are able to guarantee that, then you can just rely on security of the underlying secret sharing, non-malleable secret sharing. Okay? So now, here's our second attempt. We just changed the parameters of the secret sharing scheme. If, let's say, this was T out of N secret sharing scheme, where assume that T is greater than 3, greater than or equal to 3, then you share R using just a 2 out of N secret sharing scheme. So L and R kind of have different parameters. And we will show that this is already very interesting. This allows you to actually get some kind of non-malleability. So remember that 2 shares of R are enough to reconstruct R, whereas 2 shares of L, they are not enough to reconstruct L. Now let's go back to our previous picture. So adversary applies these tampering functions and we get these modified shares. Okay, and now observe that if you had two of these modified shares, then you can reconstruct R tilde. However, because this is an individual tampering model, these two modified shares in turn can only depend on two shares of L. Okay, because you take one share of L and R and you get one share of tempered L and tempered R. But because L was shared using a 3 out of n secret sharing scheme or even with higher parameters, two shares of L completely hide what L is. Okay, so two shares of R depend only on two shares of L. Two shares of R fix R, but two shares of L have no information about L. So from this we can conclude that R tilde actually only depends on L1 and L2 here, which have no information about L. So R tilde does not depend on L. Okay, so this idea, it seems like we are making progress, but we need independence in both directions. We also need that the tampering of L should not depend on R, whereas the other direction is still not clear. Okay, so I have a very nice picture showing the intuition behind one direction. In some sense, we are showing that polynomials of different degree have some sort of non-malleability with respect to each other. So here is the polynomial which represents the secret sharing of L. Let's say it has degree at least 2 or higher. Now, suppose you were to tamper L1 and get R1 tilde, tamper L2 and get R2 tilde. So this defines a line. And now this line is entirely independent of L. In particular, the secret, the zeroth point of this line, which is R tilde, is entirely independent of L. It's because two points here don't tell you anything about L. So this is kind of the key takeaway message from this first idea. And again, we still have a problem in the other direction, right? So in the other direction, we will solve this problem by using something called as leakage resilient secret sharing. So again, this is something that we obtain a construction for. So what is leakage resilient secret sharing? It's a very natural notion. So suppose that you have this R and you secret shared R into n shares, right? Let's say each share is something like 100 bits. Now an adversary comes and then adversary is obtaining individual leakage from each of these shares. And this leakage must be much smaller than the size of the share. Okay, so from each of these R's you are, let's say, downloading something like 10 bits. And let's call this leakage L1 tilde, L2 tilde, and so on. Now, if you looked at all of these leaked values, leakage resilient secret sharing requires that this still should not give you any information about R. So, so if for all of these leakage functions, the output G1 of R1 and so on, it should be statistically independent of R. And the construction idea is based on extractors. And now let's come back to the previous slide and let's say you had actually this leakage resilient secret sharing. Now, the idea is that you can think of these tampered shares as leakage on shares of R. And we will make the shares of R to be much bigger than shares of L. And L1 tilde can be thought of as leakage on R1. L2 tilde can be thought of as leakage on R2 and so on. Now, since this entire leakage is supposed to be independent of R, this means that now L tilde is independent of R as well. And using the previous idea, we already established that R tilde is independent of L. And now we can rely on the underlying guarantee. Looking at the definition of 2 out of 2 secret sharing, we just need that L and R should be tampered independently. And we have shown that L tilde is independent of R and R tilde is independent of L. And then that's it, right? Okay. So now, you know, I had some slides on joint tampering as well. Let's skip them. Okay. So now let me come to some of the applications and open problems. So one obvious application of non-malleable message, non-malleable secret sharing is in this problem of non-malleable message transmission, where, for example, we have a sender and a receiver, and the sender wants to send a message to the receiver such that either you receive the original message or the original message is destroyed and you receive something unrelated. So now the sender can actually just divide the message into various parts, send it across all these paths, and even if all of these routers, they are tampering with the individual shares, you can obtain the guarantee that you wanted. Okay, so some future directions, some open problems. So for overlapping joint tampering, our result was very weak, just n out of n. The question is, can you construct better overlapping joint tampering schemes? Can you construct better leakage resilient secret sharing schemes? And again, the question is also, can you improve the rate? So several of these problems we have made some progress on. There have been some published works. Akshay, who is a visitor here, he'll give a talk on the same topic in a couple of weeks. And yeah, that's all I have.